हेलो, दिस इज मोहम्मद नाफिजुर रहमान, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, मोहम्मद हुसैन यू कॉलेज ढाका। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस ऑन इंग्लिश रोमांटिक पोइट्री फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ ऑनर्स सेकेंड ईयर। इन दिस पार्ट टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस ऑन विलियम वर्ड्सवर्थ एंड हिज पोएम। इन द स्क्रीन यू जस्ट सी दैट there are two pictures of William Wordsworth. William Wordsworth is an English romantic poet. With Samuel Taylor Coleridge, they jointly helped to launch the Romantic Age in English literature with their joint publication called Lyrical Ballads, published in 1798. Lyrical Ballads is a group of poems composed by two famous English romantic poets, William Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge, which is published in 1798. After that period, it is called the Romantic Age. Romantic period starts after publication of these Lyrical Ballads. Wordsworth's magnum opus is generally considered to be the prelude, a semi-autobiographical poem of his early years that he revised and expanded a number of times. It was posthumously titled and published by his wife in the year of his death, before which it was generally known as the Poem of Coleridge. Wordsworth was Britain's poet laureate from 1843 until his death. From Coleridge on 23rd April 1850. Today we are going to discuss a very famous poem composed by William Wordsworth, London 1802. London 1802 works on so many levels. First of all, it's a call for help. The poet William Wordsworth laments the state of England and expresses his fears about the health of the national character. Second, it's an elegy for John Milton, a great English poet of the 17th century. Finally, it has just a gosh darn good old-fashioned sonnet. So this is a sonnet. We know that a sonnet is a poem of 14 lines written in an iambic pentameter line. Let's see the sonnet London 1802, composed by William Wordsworth. Milton! So here from the very beginning we see that the poet William Wordsworth addressed Milton, means John Milton. He was the famous English poet of 17th century. Thou shouldest be living at this hour. Thou means you. This is an archaic version. Modern English, it's called you. Thou shouldest be living at this hour. So, at this time, you should have present in this world. England hath need of thee. Thee means you. Hath means has. English, England has need of you. She is a fan of stagnant waters. Fan of stagnant waters means water which is stable in a particular place and it becomes defiled or polluted due to no movement of water. Altar here symbolizes religion. Sword means power, military power, might. And pen means the writings of the writer or poet. Fireside here means home. The heroic wealth of hall and bower. Here the heroic wealth of hall and bower symbolizes economy of a country. Have forfeited their ancient English dower of inward happiness. Now at this period, at this time, modern time, we see that the glorious past of English religion, English political power and their poet, their home, their economy, everything has been defiled or polluted. And people are losing their happiness. We are selfish men. We see that. Now the people of England has become very selfish and they become debased. Oh, raise us up, return to us again. The poet William Wordsworth addressed Milton, please come back and recover us from this debased society, debased country, and give us manners. Give us manners, give us virtue, give us freedom, give us power. Thy soul was like a star. Your soul, thy means your. Your soul was like a star and dwelt apart. Thou hadest a voice. Thou means you hadest been had. You had a voice whose sound was like the sea, which can arouse everything. Pure as the naked heavens, majestic, free, so didst thou travel on life's common way. So, your traveling, your writing, your preaching, everything was not very common. In cheerful godliness, and yet thy heart the lowest duties on herself did lay. Now we are just going to discuss the whole poem. The poem begins with a plaintive call to John Milton, a much-loved and respected English poet, and one of Wordsworth's great influences. The speaker laments the fact that Milton isn't around anymore, since, as he sees it, England needs a guiding voice. The speaker flat out condemns the state of the nation, saying that it's a stagnant swamp, and that the English people have forgotten all the things that used to make them so glorious, including religion, military might, and literature. The speaker worries that the Englishmen of his day are too selfish and debased, and wishes John Milton could return and give the nation a good old-fashioned lecture, which could change the old and polluted society. The poet is certain that Milton could inspire England to greatness once again and mold its inhabitants into more noble creatures. The second half of the poem dwells on Milton's high points. The speaker gets all soony about Milton's writing and uses celestial imagery to show us just how divine it is. Not only is Milton's writing admirable, apparently so was his character. The man could do no wrong. The speaker goes gaga over the all-around loveliness that was Milton, and ends the poem by praising the deceased poet's humility. The poet calls out to Milton and wishes that he was still alive in the present day. Apparently, the speaker thinks that Milton could help England on the whole out. He sees the country as a fen, a kind of swamp full of gross standing water. Standing water here, identify polluted water. The speaker is distressed by the fact that certain elements of traditional English life have lost their magic. To go piece by piece, he is worried about religion, that means altar, or our military concert, that means sword, literature, that here symbolizes, that here signifies pain, the home here presented fireside, and the economy presented in the poem the heroic wealth of hall and bower. So basically, everything, he is concerned with perception that these things are no longer tied to the inner happiness of the English people. In former days, they were fundamentally linked to the rightful success of the nation. This is the dower, a kind of gift that the speaker refers to. But now these institutions have lost their meaning. The speaker declares that we, that means the English people of his time, are selfish and debased, and he begs Milton to help them get out of their slum. The speaker thinks that Milton could inspire the English to be better all around, nicer, more virtuous, and more powerful. Milton was a very special. The poet uses a simile to compare the older writer to a star, something removed from the mass of humanity and superior to the rest of us. In these lines, the speaker's not actually talking about Milton's speaking voice. Instead, he is referring to his poetic voice. Basically, he claims that Milton's poetry was as powerful and amazing as the forces of the natural world, like the sea and the sky. Instead of continuing to rave about Milton's hyperbolic virtues as a poet, the speaker takes the last few lines to let us know that Milton was a good guy too. Instead of getting all up on himself, he followed life's common way, just like the rest of us, and lived his life happily and virtuously. Milton, according to the speaker, didn't just rest upon his laurels and get all arrogant about how awesome he was. The closing lines of the poem emphasize his humble nature. Instead of talking it easy, Milton took on the lowest duties. That is, he didn't avoid unglamorous tasks. Perhaps he is referring to Milton's intense and unflinching observations of human nature, symbolism, imagery, and wordplay. Milton, lines 1 and 2. Well, it is no secret as to whom this poem is addressed. Wordsworth immediately invokes Milton, using apostrophe throughout the poem. The poet directly addresses the big John Milton himself in line number 7. Again, Wordsworth apostrophizes Milton, begging him to return from the dead and help England find itself again. In line number 10, Wordsworth expresses the power of Milton's voice in this simile, in which he compares it to the sea. English tradition, line number 3 and 4. Here we get a huge list of symbols of England's past glories. First, let's have an eye here, altar. Altar here represents the English church, and fireside stands in for the security of home. We also have two instances of metonymy. One is sword, represents the British military, and pen indicates the entire English literary tradition. In line number 5, Wordsworth uses metaphor here to describe inward happiness as a dower, that means dowry, a kind of gift rightfully owed to the English people. The natural world, line number 2, from 2 to 3, grows. The first appearance of nature occurs here. In Wordsworth's striking metaphor for the country, which calls England a fen of stagnant water. This isn't quite the floral, sheep-filled idyll we usually imagine when we think of romantic poetry. This grotesque image of sickly standing water shows us that there is something rotten in the state of England. In line number 10, this next natural image is more positive. We have got more water here, but it's in a much better state. Wordsworth crafts a simile to describe Milton's poetic voice here, comparing it to the sea. The themes of the poem, theme of patriotism, theme of admiration, theme of morality and ethics, theme of tradition and customs, theme of literature and writing. These are the theme of the poem. Okay, thank you very much.